Today I'm going to attempt to do what hours upon hours of Democratic debates have failed to. Answer the question of, what are the benefits and problems with having private insurers in a Medicare for All system? Alright candidates, I get that people apparently like private insurers, and I understand that private insurers make money saying no. Now if you could just shout those talking points at each other for the period of several debates and let me run ads over that, that'd be great. Now because I heard private insurance more times than the word the at the last debate, I thought, I'll see what all the fuss is about. Apparently, peer pressure works. Now one thing that immediately becomes apparent as soon as you start trying to look into this story is how little is actually written about it. Now there are two types of articles you come across when you're researching this. You're either getting polls about how many Americans support banning private insurance, or criticism about how the framing of this issue as a pro or anti-banning private insurance debate is super misleading. Unfortunately, because of this, there aren't going to be a ton of reputable videos I can cut to. Yeah, sorry, this is a mainly me episode. Get used to this mug. For now though, let's stick with the ban all private insurance paradigm we're all used to. We'll get to the problems with that thinking in a bit. Why would you want to ban private insurance? Well, let me flip that question on its head. In a Medicare for All system where we're all getting free healthcare, why would you want to buy health insurance? I mean, that would be like buying a bottle of air or YouTube Red. This stuff is free, guys. So there must be some benefit to private insurance. Unless John Delaney thinks people like their private insurance so much that they keep paying for it while everyone else is getting it free. The main concern is creating a class-based system where private insurers can limit their customer pool by charging high premiums, which could also allow them to reimburse healthcare providers at higher rates than the government. So now you're in a situation where people are paying for insurance and the insurance companies are paying more to the hospitals than the government. Are people just enjoying wasting their money across the board? Well, not quite. You see, if your doctor accepts both your government coverage and another patient's private coverage, they might privilege the other patient or move them to the front of the line, because their coverage gives them a more generous reimbursement. Now here's where you find a lot of articles taking issue with the whole idea of banning private insurance. Because, and I'm really tired of saying this in these episodes, but it turns out there's a lot more nuance. From this point onward, I'm gonna reframe this episode to the more accurate question of, should the government ban duplicative coverage, and how generous should the government's own coverage offering be? Now this would be a ban on private insurance competing with the government, but it's not an out-and-out ban on private insurance. It's the reason your moderate friend can point to Canada and say, they simultaneously have universal healthcare systems and private insurance. You see, Canada doesn't cover vision, dental, or prescriptive drugs in the universal healthcare system, so people have to take out private insurance plans to supplement the government's. Now this is more the mentality that Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren subscribe to. In April, Sanders again introduced his signature healthcare legislation, which would provide government-run Medicare-style health insurance for all Americans, and outlaw most duplicative private insurance in the process. So it's banning all private health insurance in the same way that banning horses from public roads is a government ban on equestrianism. Yeah, it limits your options, but in these specific situations where you can't drive, it could also serve as a means of transportation. Now this distinction is most important because Medicare does not cover glasses, basic eye exams, hearing aids, and most dental care. Now this is where you get Bernie Sanders' famous quote.
For senior citizens, it will finally include dental care, hearing aids, and eyeglasses.
But you don't know.
Second
that.
Of all.
You don't know that.
Second
Bernie.
Of all.
We'll come to you in a second.
I do know, and I wrote the damn bill.
Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All plan punches up Medicare to include these holes. Now, there's still some places for private insurance to exist in his plan, though. For example, plastic surgery?
And what happens to those insurance companies after your plan is implemented?
Under Medicare for All, we cover all basic
health care needs. So they're not going to be there to do that. I suppose if you want to make yourself look a little bit more beautiful, you want to work on that nose, your ears, they can do that.
So basically Blue Cross Blue Shield would be reduced to nose jobs.
Something like that.
I was wondering why Speaker Pelosi was so against his plan. Now, certain other presidential candidates' Medicare for All proposals have some larger holes for private insurance. For example,
who here would abolish their private health insurance in favor of a government-run plan? Just a show of hands, start off with.
Senator Warren, I'd be a little more hesitant with that hand raise. Kind of like the kid in the back who wants credit for trying but doesn't exactly have the right answer. Her plan, while definitely sterile Medicare for all, doesn't expand Medicare to the same extent Sanders does, so there's still some holes where private insurance can operate. If she actually eliminated private insurance, nobody would have vision or dental in her plan. It shrinks a lot, but it doesn't eliminate it. Now, before I move on to the let private industry compete with Medicare for all part of the episode, there's one other argument against competition that, entering this episode, I thought was going to be the main argument against competition: Medicare's negotiating ability. One of the largest benefits of a single-payer system is, well, there's a single payer. You can save a ton of money if your Department of Health and Human Services can speak for the entire country of America. You want to charge Americans how much for insulin? Well, then you can join Purdue Pharmaceutical in the bankruptcy line, because Americans aren't paying that price. This conversation has mostly been focused on prescription drugs, as Medicare, the current largest insurer in America, cannot negotiate drug prices for pharmaceutical drugs directly. Bernie Sanders has long led the charge to change that and make the Department of Health and Human Services negotiate directly with pharmaceutical companies. Now, it goes without saying that the more people that the HHS secretary represents, the more negotiating power he's going to have when talking to these people, and the more savings the government will enjoy in drug price reductions. Alright, now that we're all amped up and ready to go all in for Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren, let me pour some cold water on this enthusiasm and tell you why we should let private insurance companies into our Medicare for All system. This type of bill is championed by Kamala Harris and Pete Buttigieg. Now, John Delaney made a weird argument, but I have to mention it, supporting this public-private competition.
It's been well documented that if all the bills were paid at Medicare rate, which is specifically, I think it's in section 1200 of their bill, then many hospitals in this country would close. I've been going around rural America, and I ask rural hospital administrators one question. If all your bills were paid at the Medicare rate last year, what would happen? And they all look at me and say, we would close.
So, Medicare for All is too good? Essentially, yes. If Medicare for All abolished private insurance and reduced rates to Medicare levels at least 40% lower by one estimate, there would most likely be significant changes throughout the healthcare industry. Apparently, our hospital's lifeblood is the utter incompetence and inefficiency of private insurers. I mean, they're paying 40% more than government for the same procedures. You guys know you can negotiate, right? In a shocking revelation, on average, the government program pays hospitals about 87 cents for every dollar of their costs, compared with private insurers that pay $1.45. They're literally losing money on these Medicare operations. Hospitals could stand to lose as much as $151 billion in annual revenue, a 16% decline under Medicare for All. This could see layoffs and the closure of more rural hospitals at the same time as demand is increasing, because, well, it's free. People have a few responses to this issue. Some say the government could just pay more. Of course, if they are paid more than Medicare rates, the final price tag for this program could balloon from the already stratospheric estimate of upward of $30 trillion over a decade. Some say they're going to save a ton of money on administrative costs because they're only dealing with one buyer now. And my personal favorite solution comes from the chief executive at Jefferson Hospital, who essentially said, hospitals would just have to innovate new ways of ripping off the government. He said, quote, Some hospitals could replace their missing revenue by charging more for the same care, or by ordering more billable tests and procedures. You'd be amazed. Remind me to steer clear of your hospital. Now, for the rest of the arguments, we're gonna leave the Canadian model of a non-compete setup between the government and private insurers and instead enter the British healthcare system, where you have the simultaneousness of National Health Service that provides free healthcare to everybody, and you turn on the TV and see commercials like this.
I think there are three main reasons why people choose to purchase private healthcare. Number one is to have the choice of seeing the most appropriate consultant with the subspecialty interest for their problem. Number two is for ease of access and convenience of their appointment times to go and see a specialist. And number three is the quality of the surroundings and the quality of the environment in which they will receive their treatment.
Again, Great Britain's National Health Service, which provides free healthcare to everyone. But if you want to go to a hospital where they drink their tea with their pinky out, you're going to have to buy special health insurance on top of the amount that the government charges you in taxes to fund the NHS. Now this gives you immediate access, skipping lines, and, well, you heard the man, I'm starting to sound like a second ad for his company. Now this sounds like, well, exactly what I was complaining about earlier, but depending on who you are, it could be good. If the government healthcare system starts to fall apart, this could be your lifeboat. Except, instead of women and children first, we're loading all the rich dudes first. A perfect example of this is in 2017. The wait time for surgeries got so long that people jumped ship and started paying cash for the operations at private hospitals. And, of course, buying private insurance. Now this provided several pros and cons. For example, anybody willing to pay more for better service will have a private insurance company paying for them, and not the federal government. And they fund the NHS with their tax dollars, but they don't use it. On the other hand, it allowed the government to put a band-aid on the healthcare system and consistently underfund it, and it did not address its core problems. Now at the core of this debate, we see three different options. We have Biden advocating for things aren't that bad, let's keep it the American system. We have Warren and Sanders saying, huh, things seem to be working out pretty well in Canada. What are they doing? We'll do Medicare for all while forbidding private insurers from competing with the government healthcare system. And then of course lastly, you have people like Buttigieg and Harris, who would look to a more British system of free healthcare for everybody. But private insurers can supplement service if people don't want to wait or endure standards that were designed to accommodate larger groups of people. I hope I did more towards helping you guys understand what this debate is actually about than 6+ hours of presidential debates. As always, thank you, and that's probably all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube! If you want to support independent, non-partisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching!